This course is about designing a landscape lighting project. The right lighting design will create the beauty, enjoyment, and many other benefits that can set you apart as a true lighting professional. In this course, we'll discuss the elements of landscape lighting design, moving from shape of a property to a drawn plan that incorporates all of the client's desires. There will be two main parts. In part one, creating the design, we'll discuss design principles, lighting techniques, the process of making a design, and how to incorporate your customer's feedback into your design. Part two, specifying fixtures and drawing the plan. We'll discuss the more technical aspects of designing and creating a plan so that you can translate your ideas into an installation diagram and parts list. The easiest way to get overwhelmed when designing is to begin with the details. The details are very important in the design, and attention to the little details often help you win a job. But the details are actually the last thing you consider when making a design. Let's begin our review of design principles by looking at the big picture, and then learn some important concepts that drive every great lighting design. This doesn't look like much of a landscape lighting design. That's because we blurred out the details so you can see more clearly what's really at issue in a lighting design: the play of light areas and dark areas. In this lighting design, we see a pool of light at the front of the property. This defines the frame of the design and creates visual distance between it and these objects that are lit up much farther back. In the middle, there's a series of pools of light that march through the middle ground, connecting the front of the design to the back. It's not a single lighted strip, but a rhythm of light areas punctuated by dark areas in between. In the center of it all is a square shape that is framed by the rest of the lights. This is the focal point of the design, and it neatly echoes the area lit in the foreground. A second set of high bright spots create another rhythm around the focal point, and these green forms help balance out the composition. Visual distance, rhythm, focal point, and balance. These are the key concepts that will make your design coherent, professional, and visually striking. Now then, let's take a closer look at a clearer picture to see how this design took shape. That's much better. First, visual distance. The obvious way to create visual distance is to illuminate elements at the edges of the property. The stone and plant here at the corner of the walkway peeks out of this front corner of the design and also helps walk the visitor along the path up the stairs to the front door. Lights on the house and trees mark the other edge of the landscape visible from this vantage point. By lighting an element at both the front and back of the space, we've created as much visual depth with light as the property allows. The essence of rhythm in music is that sometimes there is sound, and sometimes there isn't. It's the silence between the notes that gives music rhythm. Design works the same way. It's the dark spaces between the things that you light that give your design its rhythm. So, for instance, in this design, there is a dark, light, dark, light, dark, light rhythm along the stairs, and a light, dark, light, dark, light rhythm up the landscaping. The lights and darks are created in different ways. Here, by a progression of path lights, here, by grazing architectural elements, and lastly, here, by lighting a wall behind shrubs so that the silhouette of the plant material creates the dark area. Perhaps the best advice for budding designers is the quote attributed to one of the 20th century's most important modern architects, Mies van der Rohe: less is more. Think about your lighting design like fishing with a net. If you light everything, there will be no holes in the net and you won't be able to move it through the water. Now, you don't light enough and the holes will be too big and the fish will get through. Space the lighting correctly and you'll catch the fish you want and not the ones you don't. Experience has shown that new contractors have a tendency to want to light too much, so work towards lighting less, and you'll find that your net is exactly the right size. The focal point in this design is created by lighting two piers that flank the main entryway. This is the most common focal point in domestic architecture. Landscape and architectural elements around this focal point frame it and create rhythms in the space that lead up to the focal point. Sometimes a secondary focal point, like the entry to the stairwell, is used to create an echo of the main focal point and provide balance in the design, but also to create emphasis by repetition. A good design will balance in all ways around a point in the center of the design, front to back, side to side, and top to bottom. Now, this doesn't mean that it has to be perfectly symmetrical, only that there needs to be elements that are lit on all sides of this center point. The architect and landscape architect have already done a lot of work to create balance on the property. Use your lighting design to build on these decisions to create a balanced look at night. On this property, the winding path through the landscape already creates a balanced zigzag set of forms moving from the front of the property to the house in the back. The lighting design has simply highlighted critical moments along the way, notably changes in direction and elevation, which creates a nice balance from the front of the property to the back. But if this were the only lighting, there would be two pretty dark areas, or black holes, on either side of the path. A black hole is an area of the landscape that receives significantly less light than the other areas. This is why the designer has chosen to illuminate the walls of the house at several key places. This balances out the lighting design from left to right. But the balancing act isn't quite finished yet. All of the light is weighted toward the bottom of the house, and the taller areas seem to disappear into the night sky. So, the designer has chosen to illuminate three trees to round out the design, balancing the design from top to bottom as well. As we look at this design, we can see that the visual distance, rhythm, focal points, and balance are created by using light in a lot of different ways. Let's consider some of these. We'll talk about two main kinds of lighting, uplighting and downlighting, as well as some specialty lights like path lights, deck lights, hardscape lights, and many more lights. The majority of lighting effects are created by fixtures that you can't readily see when standing in the landscape. The fixtures illuminating this entryway are barely visible at the bottom of the photo here. This is what's called indirect lighting, and the goal is for the fixture to illuminate something in the landscape without itself being visible. It is either placed low to the ground and hidden in the landscape or covered with a shroud or louver. The smart designer can use this light to create areas of direct light. Areas illuminated by reflected light and by light that spills over the object being illuminated. Uplighting is usually done with accent lights, well or in-ground lights, or wall wash lights. Here are some of the techniques at the designer's disposal. Lighting from the front is the simplest form of uplighting, in which a single fixture is placed in front of what is to be illuminated and directed at that object. Best for small shrubs or plantings, lighting from the front can create dramatic effects of light and shadow on trees, within a landscape planting, and on the wall behind the plant material. The small tree illuminated by front lighting here is luminous against the shadows behind it. Shadowing is an effect created when front lighting is directed at a plant material that casts distinct shadows on the wall. Shadowing is most effective when there is a single fixture. The shadows are more visible and crisper than when shadowing with two or more fixtures. Shadowing can be great for creating visual interest, but accidental shadowing can also be visually confusing and create an obstacle to clear viewing. Try to keep your shadowing effects to walls and flat surfaces. For medium to large shrubs and for most trees, cross-lighting is a better choice for illumination than lighting from the front. When cross-lighting an object like a tree, place one fixture to each side of the object and aim them so that their beams cross in the center. Cross-lighting more evenly lights the object while creating dimension and depth. It also offers optimum viewing from all sides. If you would like an object to be visible both from the street and the inside of the house, arranging the fixtures so that one is on the front and the other on the back of the object will create a cross-lighting effect that looks great from both angles. Backlighting is when a light illuminates an object from behind, to make that object appear as a shadow instead of as a positive form. Silhouette lighting is a form of backlighting when an object is in front of a wall and a light is placed behind the object to light the wall. Once again, the object appears as a shadow or silhouette and creates a dark shape against the brighter wall behind it. A wall wash is when a light is placed in front of a wall and directed up at the wall to create a light zone in the architecture. Grazing is essentially a wall wash where the fixture is placed very close to the wall, about 6 inches away, and directed straight up, or at a severe angle from the side. Grazing is especially effective on highly textured surfaces like brick, stone, or stucco, and creates dramatic shadowing effects with the texture of the material. Mirror lighting takes advantage of the reflective surface of a pond or a pool by cross-lighting a tree or large object behind the water. The surface of the water reflects that object to create a dynamic, striking source of reflective light. Downlighting refers to situations where the light source is located above the object that is illuminated and shines down toward the ground instead of up into the atmosphere. In some locations, uplighting is not allowed by local regulations, so downlighting is the only lighting option. But no worries, there are plenty of fixtures for downlighting, including path, deck, step, and hardscape lights. Accent lights can also be directed down when mounted in trees, on walls, under soffits, on pergolas, or on other architectural elements. One of the most common approaches to downlighting is to create moonlight effects. To accomplish this, one or more fixtures is mounted high up in a tree. The beam is aimed through the branches to cast interesting shadows on the ground. This creates a soft, natural light akin to the moonlight and efficiently illuminates a large area of the property. It's great for driveways or front yards that see some use in the evening. If there are parts of the property that will be used for activities that require enough light to see well, the subtle lighting effects of the techniques listed above aren't going to cut it. For these instances, such as putting greens, basketball courts, a yard where the family plays sports after work, etc., mount accent lights in trees, on walls, or under a soffit to adequately illuminate the area. Cross-lighting might be necessary here to eliminate shadows from the activity area. In this large pool area, accent lights have been mounted to trees to illuminate the walking path. The specialty lighting techniques we will consider are all forms of uplighting or downlighting. There are fixtures designed to achieve these effects in a variety of common landscape lighting applications. Path lights might be the emblem of landscape lighting because they are the fixtures in a landscape lighting installation that you can see, but they can also be some of the most problematic. They are easier to damage because they stick up out of the landscape, and too many of them create a runway effect that really doesn't look very professional. Used judiciously, however, they are a powerful addition to the designer's toolkit. Path lights should always be used in landscape beds, never in turf, as the maintenance of the lawn will lead to their early demise. They are often installed in small shrubs or plantings to create downlighting effects within the landscape. A well-placed path light next to a step or a curve in the sidewalk can be an excellent safety precaution. It's often a good idea to use reflected light off of walls or plant material to illuminate long, straight stretches of sidewalks. A bollard works in the same way as a path light, but the light source is placed in a long glass shroud to create a softly glowing focal point in the landscape. There are a variety of deck and post lights designed to work with decks and wooden fences. These are often very small fixtures that illuminate the ground below them, identifying steps, edges or corners of a deck, or other obstacles that could pose safety hazards. Post lights mount onto 4x4 posts to create a flourish in the landscape lighting design. There are also LED strip lights that can be mounted to decks, steps, benches, or hardscapes. Additionally, there are step lights that can be set into wooden brick paver or concrete steps. These illuminate the outlines of steps for safety purposes. Hardscape lights work in much the same way that deck lights do, except they are designed to slide between the hardscape blocks for an easy installation. Tape lights mount easily with adhesive to the underside of most any surface. Great for hardscapes, decks, and fences, they can be cut to length and have simple plug-and-play installation. And now that we've discussed the lighting techniques at the designer's disposal, let's take a moment to consider some characteristics of light to help you make the best use of these lighting techniques. As we have seen, most landscape lights are directed up or down and aimed at plant material or architectural elements. Light is rarely directed out of the viewer. Bollards are one exception when the light source is visible, and in these cases, it is softened by the textured glass cover. There are two main ways to adjust the intensity of light on an object in a lighting design: adjusting the lumen output of the fixtures and adjusting the beam spread. Lumen output is a measure of the intensity of light. So, a 352 lumen fixture will produce more light than a 116 lumen fixture. Note that the two fixtures with the same wattage can have different lumen outputs. In the past, many professionals referred to the wattage of the lamp to indicate the intensity of the light. With today's LED fixtures, it is more precise to use lumens as the measure of output. We'll talk more about selecting the fixture with the proper lumen output for the application in the second half of this course. However, the beam spread of accent lights also affects the intensity of light. If two fixtures have the same lumen output, the fixture with the narrower beam spread focuses the light output over a smaller area than the fixture with the wider beam spread. The fixtures produce the same amount of light. It just gets spread out in different ways. We'll talk more about which fixtures to choose to get the desired intensity in the second half of this course. When an actor standing on stage is in the spotlight, he is directly illuminated, like this tree. Now, if you've ever been in this position, you know that it's not so comfortable. Those spotlights are bright and distracting. This is why landscape lighting relies so heavily on indirect illumination. That is, the people in the landscape should not be able to see the source of the lighting. Landscape lighting designers shine their lights on trees, plants, walls, or other architectural features so that the light reflects off of those surfaces and illuminates the space. While this involves directly lighting landscape plants or architectural features, the overall space is illuminated indirectly. One of the biggest challenges for the lighting designer is to keep light where you want it and to prevent it from going where you don't. You need to take steps to prevent glare. Places where viewers get in the direct line of a fixture and are blinded by the light source. There are a lot of tools at your disposal to help deal with this problem, including cowls, louvers, and well lights that are buried into the ground. Remember that you'll need to consider all directions from which people might look at an illuminated location, including the inside and outside of a house, from an outdoor living area, etc. Be sure that your light source can't be seen directly from any viewing area. Every landscape lighting design is a collaboration with your client who purchases your services. In preparing a design, you'll balance two considerations. First is your expertise as a designer. We'll teach you how to design for the situations you encounter on residential properties. The second consideration is accommodating any special requests by the customer. You bring your expertise in design, then refine your plan with the customer's needs and preferences. In general, the three biggest reasons that people install landscape lighting are use, beauty, or aesthetics, and safety. Landscape lighting can provide essential illumination for outdoor activities, ranging from walking from the driveway to the front door to lounging by the pool. It extends the usable time of their landscaping into the evenings, when they are most likely to use it anyway. Second, they want their house to look beautiful at night, as beautiful as that house down the street that just got landscape lighting installed. Finally, safety is a concern and a motivation for some buyers. A well-lit outdoor space deters prowlers because there is no place to hide. When we design our landscape lighting system, we will address each of these three motivations. First, we'll identify the way that the landscape is used and provide appropriate illumination for those activities. This will naturally suggest focal points for the design. Second, we'll use principles of visual distance, balance, and rhythm to fill out the design and create a beautiful, striking vista. Finally, we'll check to ensure that the property is adequately illuminated for safety. Let's take a look at a typical suburban house in a higher-end neighborhood and ask the question, how is this space used? It's not a huge mystery. The driveway is an entry and exit point for the cars, the sidewalk in front is a location where pedestrians might pass by, and there is another sidewalk leading from the driveway to the front door. The circulation pattern is therefore pretty clear. Into and out of the driveway, along this sidewalk here, and into and out of the front door. When we think about how our lighting design interacts with the needs of the property, providing illumination for high use areas is a great place to start. We want to illuminate the edges of the driveway to ensure safe entry and exit of cars. This can be accomplished by accent lighting on the trees and on either side of the driveway. The sidewalk to the entrance of the house should be illuminated to ensure visitors can easily enter and exit the house at night. You could use a few path lights to illuminate the hedge along the walkway, which would spill light onto the sidewalk. Additionally, you could light some of the plant material right in front of the house to reflect some light onto the sidewalk. The entryway of the house will be a natural focal point. Highlight this by grazing the support columns flanking the door. We can turn some light on inside the house to more clearly identify the door. And finally, path lights at key places along the sidewalk will illuminate the sidewalk for pedestrians. A home's backyard gets used in quite a different way. Often, there is a deck or patio where the homeowners might relax or entertain guests. There might be a pool or putting green. In the back, the main activity is not circulation, but resting, relaxing, playing, or socializing. This places very different requirements on the lighting. Again, it will be important to illuminate the places where people move, but the mood or ambiance will be a bit more low-key and designed for staying in one place instead of moving from one place to another. In this setting, a few well-placed deck lights and some accent lighting on the tree in the corner would facilitate easy movement and create a subtle, sophisticated ambience. This backyard has a hot tub on the left, which will be a focal point for recreational use. Let's start by making sure that people can get into and out of the hot tub without difficulty. It's important to note that landscape lighting transformers are not rated for use within 10 feet of a pool or spa. So, we'll need to mount lighting for the steps some distance away from the water. In this case, mounting an accent light high on the house opposite the spa as activity lighting, and possibly softening the light with a frosted lens, will provide illumination for the steps that is safely away from the surface of the water. A cowl could be used to prevent the light source from causing glare for the bathers in the spa. It will also be helpful to add a path light and a couple of accent lights on the foliage along the path to the hot tub to allow the late night bathers visibility on the path to the tub. This simple backyard is an outdoor living space used for relaxation, in the chairs by the tree, or having a meal at the table. A design should account for the steps up to the dining area. Step lights will do rather nicely here. LED strip lights would go well with sleek lines of this patio area to illuminate the edges of the space. Finally, using accent lighting on the trees in the space will create enough reflective light to illuminate the surface of the table and the chairs. When we talk about beauty, it's important to think about how people will be looking at it. There are two main vantage points to consider when thinking about what your customers will see when they're looking at the installation. There's the view from the curb, and there's the view from inside the house. The house is the focal point of the view from the curb, and the landscape is the focal point of the view from the house. To keep these two views balanced, you'll want to make sure that your design incorporates both elements. Now, let's work on completing a design based in use to create a beautiful end product. Let's return to our suburban house example. We've already started the design process by identifying a focal point and some areas to light to facilitate ease of entry and exit from the house. We can take cues from the architecture to help fill out the design. Things to look for when lighting architecture include peaks, coins, you know those large stones or blocks on the corners with great textures, brick or rock walls with great texture, columns, arches, and any other architectural elements that stick out. With this house, the three peaks are an excellent lighting opportunity and can be lit from below or with lights mounted onto the wall or roof. The brickwork on the garage is also a real good texture. Lights mounted under the gutter could graze this surface, which has the added benefit of lighting the potted trees in the drive. Similarly, when we look to the landscape, look for motifs or repeated forms for things to illuminate. In our example, there are large hedges at the corners of the house that create a nice rhythm across the surface, and there are a series of smaller shrubs along the walk that march across the surface of the house. The rocks along the sidewalk complement the stone base of the light at the end of the drive, and are great border elements to light in order to create visual depth in the property. Now we've got a strong base for a lighting design that can be modified to meet your customers' desires. In our second example, we will let the landscaping help us fill out the design. It's a deep yard, and we can make this visible by lighting some of the plantings farther back. Accent lights on an additional tree in the center and another path light along the edge help balance out the composition. Now there's a front, a middle, and a back to our design. This gives us a natural-looking, elegant progression of plantings visible at night. It's a well-known fact that outdoor lighting deters crime. The key to increasing security with outdoor lighting is to eliminate dark areas in the landscape that could conceal prowlers. This does not mean that the property must be lit up like a parking lot. It does, however, mean that you should be attentive to ensuring that the property is lit throughout and especially that there are no dark areas near the house. While washing or grazing on all sides of the house can go a long way to addressing this need. Illuminating areas behind large plant material, fences, or other architectural elements eliminates hiding places on a property as well. The final portion of part one of this course is about tailoring your recommendation with the customer's needs and desires. It's a good idea to have the design broken into modules so that you can easily remove blocks of fixtures or eliminate certain effects that your customer either does not desire or can't afford. This will also help create stages for installation if that is desired. Adjustments to the plan can be made in lots of ways. You can remove fixtures, adjust fixture sizes, lenses, etc. Let's consider how this might work. Let's say that your client's spouse did not make the first walkthrough of the property, but is present now for your design presentation. He or she brings new suggestions, new ideas, and new requests. How do you adjust the design on the fly? Well, because you've made the right design for the property, all you need to do is adjust the details to customize it to the new needs. Perhaps you can relocate or remove a few of the recommended fixtures, add lenses, or change beam spreads to alter the placement of the light, or even add extra fixtures without significant impact to the plan. In this section, we'll talk about the practical steps you can take to tailor a great overall plan for common customer desires. Some clients will prefer a lighting design that protects their privacy, while others desire to show off their property to create a beautiful display. Get a sense of how much light they want by getting them to talk about how they think about their new home. The architecture will help you out here too. A symmetrical, forceful facade with a prominent front entrance suggests a desire for show. An asymmetrical facade with lots of different planes and de-emphasized entrance suggests a desire for privacy. So, your desire is privacy. Here's our recommendation. While keeping the design balanced, strategically light architectural and landscape elements so that there are larger dark intervals between areas that are lit. Reducing the lighting on the house while keeping the lighting in the landscape constant will de-emphasize the architecture and lead to a sense of privacy and seclusion. A less symmetrical and rhythmically varied approach creates a more natural look, which further reinforces a more private feel to the installation. Your customer's desire? To show. Our recommendations? Make sure that the lighting hits the major elements of architectural interest, including columns, arches, peaks, and gables, coins, stone, and brick textures. A more symmetrical design generally reads as more showy. So, create regular rhythms when lighting plant materials, trees, and walls. Two terms that come up in these kinds of discussions are natural and theatrical. Here are two images that give a sense for the difference between the two. The natural look is marked by asymmetry, a few shadow effects, softer lights, and we notice that the architecture, while it receives some attention, is not emphasized. Elements of a more theatrical look are quite the opposite. Symmetry, lots of shadowing effects, crisp lighting, and an emphasis on the unique architectural features of the building. When making your initial design, pay attention to areas in the landscape that have been developed for outdoor use, including outdoor kitchens or outdoor living areas, pools, basketball hoops, or putting greens. You can ask about these specifically during your client meeting and talk about the best way to light these areas to accommodate their usual activities. If they need a light for a barbecue or above a dining table, be sure to work that into the design. Their desire? Lighting for outdoor living. Our recommendation? Keep lighting low in outdoor areas. You don't want to blind folks sitting outside or disturb the naturally flattering effects of low light. Keep lights pointed down and illuminating the edges of the outdoor living area. Customers desire? Lighting active areas like putting greens or basketball courts. We recommend activities that require more intense illumination are best lit from above. Also, consider placing these lights in their own zone so they can be turned off when not in use. Ask about their favorite parts of the house. Do they love the columns or the brick exterior? Did they fall in love with the house because of the gables or the wide porch? Identifying their favorite parts of the house can help you make decisions about how to approach your lighting design. And if there are parts of the architecture they don't care for, you can eliminate any lighting that would draw attention to those areas. You can ask the same things about landscaping, and use this as a way to start a discussion about any ideas they might have about what they would like to feature. Here are some questions you can ask that get your customers thinking about security. Does the client travel a lot? Are they worried about prowlers? Are they a prominent member of the community and therefore in need of extra security? Identifying security concerns can help make the case for an expanding lighting system that covers the entire property and not just the front of the house. What's your customer want? Security. Our recommendations? The key to providing security is eliminating dark areas on the property. Wall washes create a reflective halo of light around the house and eliminate places for prowlers to hide. Lighting trees and plants from both the front and the back will eliminate shadowy areas in the landscape. Landscape lighting for security allows the homeowner to quickly survey their property and determine that all is well. Landscape lighting is developing rapidly to include the ability to zone a system and turn individual zones on or off depending on whether or not they're used. We've already mentioned separating off activity areas that need lots of light so that they can be turned off when not in use. But zoning outdoor living spaces or backyard lighting, which do not necessarily need to be on all night, will allow your customers to save some money in electricity and customize their property's lighting level based on the activities going on at the home at the time. Questions to ask here include whether there are areas that need to be lit all the time, or whether they want manual control over certain areas of the lighting system. The most commonly heard word in landscape lighting is subtle. Many homeowners desire to have landscape lighting, but they don't want the harsh lighting they associate with commercial spaces. So be attentive to this desire. Some will want to show off their property, so subtlety isn't what they are going for. If your customer wants subtlety, here are our recommendations. The keys to subtle lighting are indirect or reflective light, not too much light, and a natural, as opposed to a theatrical, look. This doesn't necessarily mean less fixtures, but it can affect the brightness of the fixtures, their beam spread, and how they are aimed. The most oft-heard customer objection to landscape lighting is price. And installing a project in phases is a great way to address this objection. Once you've demonstrated the value of landscape lighting and impressed them with your design, you can break the project down into phases based on your customer's priorities. We've already mentioned the importance of breaking the design into modules. We'll talk about how to do that more specifically in the second part of this course. To get a sense about what order to install the phases in, ask your customers what is important to them. Are they most interested in entertaining? Then get that outdoor living space done the first year. Are they concerned about security? Make sure all the wall wash fixtures around the house are part of the first phase. Do they want to make an impact? Address the front of the house first and work around it later. Be sure to get a sense for your customers' plans for their landscape. If there is an outdoor living area, deck, or pergola in the works, installing the lighting when those features are installed can save installation time and money for the customer. Also, there's no sense in putting multiple fixtures on a tree that is about to be torn down. When creating phases for the project, work with your customer to align installation with their other plans for their landscaping. Some landscape lighting fixtures and equipment are more prone to maintenance problems than others, and path lights are a prime example of this. For instance, you should never plan to put path lights in turf, as the regular lawn care is very hard on them and will almost certainly lead to broken fixtures. Second, don't put fixtures in high traffic areas, like the ground next to the basketball hoop. Kids and pets can damage them while tearing around the yard. Plan carefully around areas of the landscaping with high maintenance needs, especially if maintenance is contracted out, or that undergo regular replanting. You'll want to keep wire out of the way of busy shovels and place your fixtures so they aren't in the way of weed trimmers, lawn mowers, or football practice. It's a good idea to set up project deadlines or milestones during that initial meeting so that you are both clear about what will happen when. If you are working with other contractors installing hardscapes, decks, pergolas, or other features, you'll need to arrange your schedule with them to keep everything on schedule. Plan for decisions and installation dates for later phases as well. A set of plans or blueprints for the house can speed up the design process considerably, especially for larger projects. Ask your customer if they have these materials available in an easy format for you to use. At this point, we've gone through the process of creating a design and modifying it to meet a customer's needs and desires. The next step in understanding how to design a landscape lighting system is to get that design down on paper, which is the subject of part 2 of this course. I'll see you there.